the right thing for a change, huh? Well, here it is, Mr. Walter Regan, Magnet and Steel, back to 1970s on WABC, I mean WPAT. Okay. Walter, stand by from your hotel room, okay? In 1978, I remember that very well. Walter Regan, I believe, was born not too far from where I'm from, Jamaica, New York. I was from Suffern, New York. I suffered, but I didn't get out. And I'm still in Suffern all throughout all my years, all my tender moments, Mr. Brad Williger, right? Here's Walter Regan, just for you. Great stuff right here with Bob O'Brien. We play it all night here at WPAT, and it's It was great hearing you all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks to you. You're people like you that make the show happen. Now, you've been out in the world. You've been with Stevie Nicks. You've been with some of the great, great, great people in rock and roll. You want to give us some experience working with Stevie Nicks or anyone else for that matter?
Well, it was a great thrill for me to work with Stevie. And in fact, you know, Magnum Steel was written about Stevie. And so it actually kind of... life imitates art, imitates life, with Stevie singing on it. So it was like a closed circuit thrill for me when Stevie got to sing on that. But I have a song called Tunnel of Love that she was recording the backgrounds on my first album, the Fundamental Role album on Columbia. And on the way home, after experiencing her doing her banshee wail behind the song of mine, which is probably the most salacious song I've ever written. My grandmother was kind of shocked when she heard it. But on the way home, I was driving behind a car, and it had a license plate that said, "Not Shy." And by the time I got home, I had finished most of the lyrics to that song. So it's an amazing kind of thing when things happen cosmically like that. And in my life, it seems like that happens a lot. You know, my middle name is Lindsay, and Lindsay Buckingham, you know, produced my records, and we were both influenced by the Beach Boys and Kingston Trio, and it's, you know, you have too short a show for me to go on and on for all these cosmic things that's happened to me, but, you know, it was great working with Stevie and with Lindsay. I got to see Stevie and Lindsay in the same week a couple of weeks ago down in Nashville when they were both separately touring through town.
What was that like? How did that go?
It was great, you know. I don't get to see them that often, and it was wonderful, you know. Stevie was really warm, and so was Lindsay, you know. I mean, we spent a lot of time together for about 2-3 years there, and it's really nice to be able to reconnect with them, you know. I think it's great that they're both out there doing so well. Stevie was opening for Rod Stewart, and Lindsay's doing a solo tour with he and about 45 guitars. So it was a thrill to see him. And then, you know, you mentioned that I worked with Stevie. Well, I've worked with a lot of people over the years.
Like Van Halen, right? Steven
Tyler. Actually, Aerosmith was managed by one of my managers back in the day, David Krebs. But I worked, you know, Emmy Lou Harris was a good friend of mine. I went to Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., and the first dorm I lived in on campus, I lived in the same dorm as Bill Clinton, so that was pretty bizarre. But
it was an experience, I'm sure, yes.
Well, really, the first thing I saw when I was moving into my dorm room was a flyer that said, "This is Clinton country." And he was already running for junior class president at Georgetown, so he hadn't changed a bit, I guess. But one of his classmates and a good friend of mine is Bill Danoff. And Bill, of course, wrote